us honor our King. Blessed are the people who know the sound of the shofar. In the light of your countenance, O Yahweh, shall they walk. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kitchanu bebesito v'tzivanu lishmoa kol shofar. Blessed are you, Yahweh Elohim, King of the universe, who sanctified us with his commandments and has commanded us to hear the voice of the shofar.
Stared down into the valley, filled with dried bones baking in the sun. Remains that used to be a mighty army, to him it looked like the fighting days were done. But driven by your calling on his life, he spoke God's words, the bones began to shake. He stared wide-eyed as the flesh began to form. And as it prophesied to the wind, the soldiers began to wake. And the Lord sent his wind into the valley and breathed the breath of life into their souls and raised them again a mighty army. Soon these arisen warriors will battle again, but they have been filled with the Spirit wind. A pastor stands before his congregation, once a mighty army for the Lord. But now he stares into the lifeless eyes, believers leading carnal lives. He wonders what they're fighting for. But driven by your calling on his life, he spoke God's word like he'd done 100 times before. This time he comes broken and weeping, the tears of a broken heart, and he cries out to the Lord. Oh Lord, send your wind into this valley and breathe the breath of life into their souls and raise them again a mighty army. For soon these arisen warriors will battle again. They have been filled with the Spirit of wind. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Breathe your life in me. Holy Spirit.
Filled with the Spirit wind.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
That was awesome, guys.
So beautiful.
You know, we was talking about this. You know, we've been teaching ever since after Pesach and the Feast of Unleavened Bread about the Holy Spirit, about the giving of the Torah, and how this journey and all of these connections that he's been doing. And we're just praying that the Holy Spirit, the Ruach, because like we talked about last week, he is our helper. He's the one that helps us pray when we don't know how to pray. He's the one that helps us understand the Torah when we read things and they don't seem to line up with our redneck ways. And so we have to learn that we have to sort of go into his ways, not our own ways. And then also how to walk out in obedience. And that's one thing we learned last week was if you're not going to obey the Torah, praying and trying to understand it is fruitless. And so we're just so thankful that he's so proactive in our lives in every area, spirit, soul, and body. You know, as while we're here on this earth being witnesses for the gospel, taking the gospel to the people, and just, you know, increasing his kingdom while we're here on this earth. Amen. It's Amen. Just been awesome.
And there's a lot of themes that go with this festival. One thing it is, it's an annual reminder of the liberation that we have, that we are no longer slaves. We are not slaves to sin. We don't have to be. We are not slaves to the Egyptian ways. We can celebrate that. And what I love along the way, too, is we get these stops in our festival. You know, we counted up 50 days to reach today, which is a constant reminder of the Jubilee, which ultimately the final Jubilee is going to be when everything returns back to the original owner, that is Yahweh Elohim and Yeshua, his son, and we are living, ruling, and reigning with him. So Amen. That's one of the beautiful things. Another is the spirit of unity. They were all, the mixed multitude was gathered together at the base of the mountain to receive the Torah, which this day commemorates. And again, Yeshua's last words before he ascended, and 8 days later, the giving of the Spirit happened when he said, "Tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power on high." And it said that they were all in one accord in the upper room. And that one accord is what allows the... this is a word we've been getting for a few days now. We've mentioned it here. Is he wants breakthrough so we can have a breakout of Amen. The gospel of the truth of Yeshua as a Messiah and his way of life. Amen. So we're no longer considered a lawless people. And it just as in a little side, too, that I think is kind of neat. It's been happening this whole week. And so, I mean, this whole festival season is the fact that if we believe and trust the way that we count, the way it was in the days of Yeshua, which we always say there's three historical documents that land that way, then it shows you that it was a Friday, a sixth day, that the outpouring of the Spirit happened. And I know he knows everything from the foundations of the earth. He intends what he intends. So if that's true, then is it fitting that man who was created on the sixth day would also be given the Spirit which circumcises our hearts for the kingdom on the sixth day of the week? It's just a thought. Amen. Just consider. I'm not saying 100,000% that's what it is. I'm just saying I can lean into that because he is so perfect in all of his patterns. Why deviate now, right?
Amen.
That's how it lands this year. So I just have a little higher expectation than I usually do that he's going to give us those breakthroughs, those healings, those things that we're believing for.
Amen.
So that we can continue walking through this next season equipped for that which he's called each of us to do. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Also, you know, we were yesterday afternoon, this is a lot of times in tradition, they read the story about Ruth and Boaz. And so we were, you know, watching one of these old, I don't know, movies.
The story of Ruth.
The story of Ruth, but it was...
Yep.
Yeah, and so, you know, that's right. It's one of them oldies, you know, like the Charlton Heston oldens, you know what I'm saying? But anyway, but I was just really mindful that how the Father does not leave, even though he's made a covenant with Israel, but how through Abraham, all the nations will be blessed. All of those who can come in through the covenant now of Yeshua will be blessed. He doesn't leave. So you saw where Boaz, and then you see, you know, Ruth, a Moabitess, comes in and ends up being grafted in, because when she made that statement, your Elohim will be my Elohim. Where you go, I will go. Who you, that's right, your people's my people. And so this is what the Father has been doing for over 2,000 years now, is bringing the nations in. He scattered Israel out to be able to deposit His Word, His Torah. And I see it, like you said, over the last 20, 25 years, I'm seeing now it coming more into fruition of how all of this is really happening for this congregation. And as we were praying up here earlier, we were mainly praying that for those, because this is a Friday to most people. This is a day that's an ordinary day that they're looking forward to just getting off. But my prayer has been that the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of this place, would just radiate out. And when people drive by, that something will happen, that they will have an encounter. Not only that we would have an encounter here, but that they would have an encounter. Because this is important, because we're going to be doing this until He returns for His bride. And then she said about being betrothed to Him, we're married to Him. And there's a lot of people out there in the Christian world that have the faith and the testimony of Yeshua, but they just don't have the Torah. They don't have that betrothal aspect of the commandments. So the Father's going to write this thing before he comes, and it's just the beauty of it. So I'm just praying that today, that even though we're here doing what we're doing, it is prophetic that goes out Amen. Into our family and our friends and our communities.
Amen. If you guys will pull this slide up, let's read John 8:34-36. Yeshua answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is the slave of sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son does remain forever." Amen. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. And that is very good news for those of Amen. Us in the Messiah, and a motivation to lead others to Him. Amen. James 1:25, "But one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty." Just a little side road here, y'all. It is not bondage to keep the commandments of Yahweh.
Amen.
The Bible says it's liberty, because what it's liberty is from the bondages of sin. Obedience is never bondage. Amen. And it abides by it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer. This man will be blessed in what he does. That is a promise to us. You know who wrote this? The brother of Yeshua. I think if anybody knows, he knows.
Amen.
That you will be blessed. We will be blessed. Amen. It's a promise we need to hang on to. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, yeah. So I do want to say, as we were watching the story of Ruth yesterday evening, I told Mark, I said, you know, I've been teaching the book of Galatians, and he goes over about the mystery of the Gentiles, which really ties back to the fullness of the Gentiles, which goes back to Ephraim, the house of Ephraim, and what he was told with the blessing from his father, Jacob. And I said, you know, this is a mystery, that a Moabitess who said, "Your people will be my people." It's the most beautiful grafted in story. And from her comes prophets and kings and royalty through one woman who is willing to stand against a culture and say, "Your people will be my people, your Elohim, my Elohim." And you know, that's a beautiful mystery that's being revealed all around, is the Amen. Grafting in of the nations. So that's another celebration of today.
Amen.
Amen. Get ready to count the Omer for the final time this season. "Blessed are you, Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with His commandments and commanded us to count the Omer. Today is the 50th day of the Omer." Amen. One more time. "Elohim, be gracious to us and bless us and cause His face to shine upon us, that Your way may be known on the earth, Your salvation among all nations. Let the peoples praise You, O Elohim. Let all the peoples praise You. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for You will judge the peoples with uprightness and guide the nations on the earth. Let the peoples praise You, O Elohim. Let all the peoples praise You. The earth has yielded its produce. Elohim, our Elohim, blesses us. Elohim blesses us that all the ends of the earth may fear him. Amen.
Amen.
All right, this will be the Shavuot blessing. Let's say it all together. You chose us for your service from among all peoples, loving us and delighting in us. You exalted us above all nations by hallowing us through your commandments. You drew us near, O our King, to your service and called us by your great and holy name. And you gave us in love, O Yahweh our Elohim, Sabbaths for rest, holidays for gladness, festivals and seasons for rejoicing. You granted us this Sabbath day and this Feast of Weeks, the season of our Torah, as a holy gathering commemorating our liberation from Egypt. Our Elohim and Elohim of our fathers, remember us and accept us as you remember our fathers, Jerusalem, your holy city, all your people, the house of Israel, but especially Messiah, the son of David, through whom you bring deliverance and well-being, grace, faithful love and mercy, life and peace on this day of the Feast of Weeks. Remember us this day, O Yahweh our Elohim, for our good and for a life of blessing. According to your promise of salvation and mercy, deliver us and be gracious to us. Have compassion on us and spare us. To you we look, for you are a gracious and compassionate Elohim and King. Amen.
Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kevod, Malkuto, Leolam Vaed. Hear, O Israel, Yahweh our Yah, Yahweh is one. Blessed be his name and his glorious kingdom forever. Te'ahavta et Yahweh Eloheka, b'kol levavka, v'b'kol nafshika, v'b'kol me'odeka, ve'hayu ha'devrim ha'ele, asher enoki mitzavka hayom al levaveka, v'shinantam levaneka, v'dibartobam b'shiftika b'viteka, Uvlektika Vaderek, Uvshakbika, Uvikumeka, Ukshartam Leod Al Yadeka, Behayu Latodafot Beneneka, Uktaftam Mesazot Beteka, Uvishareka, Behaftalareka Kamoka. You shall love Yahweh your Elohim with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen.
All right, let's all extend our hands toward the children, and Julia's going to lead us in our prayer.
Abba, open your eyes, see you, see your name, amen.
And all together say, by his grace, not one will be lost.
May Yahweh protect and defend you. May he always shield you. Israel a shining day. May you be like Ruth and Sabbath prayer. For our walk in this world, they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. They give us strength, help us cope. In this world, wherever we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words in part. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words long preserved for our world. In this world they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient
ready. We're going to be doing the waving of the challah here in just a moment. The waving of the challah is something that, you know, the high priest would do. And there again, I just want to just say a few things about it. I'm just going to read a couple of scriptures, because there again, when we're looking at these feasts, when we were during the time of Passover and unleavened bread, there was no leaven in the bread, because during that time, leaven represented sin. But now here, Shavuot, we're sitting here and we see beautiful bread, and what makes this like it is the leaven that's there. And so we're just going to read some scriptures that talk about that. If I can get to them, there we go. Matthew 13:33 says this: He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven that the woman took, and she hid 3 measures of flour. There's a lot to do with this parable, and I'm not going to just come out into the whole thing, but it says, until that it was all leavened. So we see that during this time of the Torah given to the children of Israel back in the times when they came out of Egypt, as well during the time of the disciples, whenever the Holy Spirit was given. And there's one thing that, you know, is Halisa was teaching us, that really today we're in law school. This is what we're doing. He's teaching us and equipping us, because if we're going to be ones, and we're talking all over, if we would ever be the one chosen to be the one standing in the gates, you're the ones that's going to be there to whenever they're bringing their cases to you to be decided. So you can see that here that we are learning the Torah, something that we didn't know about as we were. Now, I'll just say that a lot of our kids has been raised in Torah. You know, there's not like me. I've been through every denomination and every flavor. You know, I'm sort of like Neapolitan up here. You know, just a little bit of every flavor as we come through to where we are today. But the Holy Spirit is there given to us, again, that we would help us understand what the Word is saying. That we would rightly divide the Word of truth is what Paul told Timothy. And that's what we're trying to do today. And so here we see that this is a representation of we're supposed to go and witness. This thing is supposed to grow because Yeshua is the bread of life. And so with that, we are like little pieces of challah, like we're little pieces, you know, of matzah that we would go out, or little pieces of manna, or whatever you want to say, that we would go out and that we would bear fruit that others would partake. And then that would be deposited in them where they would grow, they would get saved, they would make Yeshua their king. And then the Father would fill them with the Holy Spirit and fill them with the Torah that they would go out and multiply. So we see here that in that parable, that was the reason of the parable, that this leaven was hid in there. Acts 1:3, I'm just going to read through 8. Acts 1:3, it says, He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs. Now I thought about this. So this is Yeshua. He's resurrected. He came to them many different times. He is with them now, teaching them something. So when it says by many proofs, that stood out to me. So I said, you know what? I wanted to go and see if Josephus read anything or put anything about that. And he did. Because here's a man who didn't have a dog in the fight. He was one who was given by the Romans to bring the history of all that was going on during that time. Because like the children of, or the people in Egypt, just like the Romans, they loved their history. They pinned down everything, whether it was right or not. They pinned everything down. But this is called the Testimonium of Flavium, which is Flavius Josephus. It says, About this time there lived Yeshua, a wise man, if indeed one ought to call him a man. He recognized this because of all the miracles that happened during his lifetime, because he was alive and he penned this. He's writing the history for the Romans. For he was one who performed surprisingly deeds and was a teacher of such people as accept the truth, and that they accepted the truth gladly. He won over many of the Jews and many of the Greeks. He was the Messiah. Now Joseph acknowledged that he was the Messiah. Josephus, I'm sorry. And when upon the accusations of the principal men among us, Pilate had condemned him to the cross, those who had first come to love him did not cease. He appeared to them, spending a third day restored to life. For the prophets of Elohim had foretold these things and 1,000 other marvels about him. This is what he witnessed. And the tribe of the believers, so called after him, has still to this day not disappeared. And so I thought that was very interesting as I was reading these scriptures, that it talked about many proofs that even Josephus recognized these, and even he himself recognized him as the Messiah. Verse 4, and while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Master, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? See, there again, they're still in their minds, they're still wanting to be delivered from Rome. In this moment, here you've done this, you've died, we understand now. What is this the time? But yet he tells them something. And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. So he's addressing directly to them. He's not saying it's not for us to know the times and seasons. He's telling us times and seasons. This is what he's doing. He's restoring it to us. But at the moment, don't focus on this, because it's not going to be restored in your time. It's going to be restored in another time, after 2 days, and then in the third day. And we're in that third day at the beginning. He says, but you will receive, this is what is for you. This is what you're to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And he has scattered his people over the years with the message now of regathering them. Giving us the, just like we have the example of Daniel. Daniel, they went out into captivity. They went out into Babylon. And even though he was there, people always say sometimes, think about this, guys. He was not in the land, but yet he wouldn't eat the king's meat and he wouldn't drink the king's wine. Even where he was scattered, he would look towards Jerusalem, and that he would pray and he would yearn for the time. And they would do the Torah, and they would fulfill the Torah as much as they could, even in captivity. Because him praying 3 times a day is what got him thrown in the lion's den. So see, if it didn't matter, he would say, well, I'll just go. No, it matters. It is matter. It matters, because he's saying here that his witnesses, it's Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. And this is what he's been restoring to us. And then I'll finish up with this, Philippians 2, 1 and 2. We talked about this a couple of Shabbats. So if there is any encouragement in Messiah, any comfort of love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection, any sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind. This is what we were talking about. Whenever the Torah was given, when they were at the base of that mountain, they were all in camp. They were all of the same mind. This is exactly what was happening in Acts. When they were tarrying, they were of the same mind, having the same love, being full accord, and of one mind. And I wrote down this right here. Can we live this way year-round? Not just every feast that when we come to, that where we study and we bring ourselves and we prepare ourselves, but can we do this? And this is what the teachings are all about, is that we would love Him, and that we would love our neighbors ourselves, and that we would be one mind and one accord, no matter where we would be on this earth, no matter where we're here, no matter where we're, if we're in Israel and we're visiting our brothers and sisters there, that we could have the mind of Messiah, that we would flow that way. He is doing that more and more, because we have to get ourselves out of the way and let Him do what He needs to do. This is why we were saying the other day, the more you fill yourself with Torah, if you don't put Torah in, the Holy Spirit has nothing to work with. Is that not right? I mean, if you don't have any Torah in there, what's the Holy Spirit got to work with? He's not a magician. He's not. So this is why we have our part. We read, we pray, we study, we fast. And then when we do it, then we can be instant in season and out of season, because the Holy Spirit can grab what's in there and he can use it just like that by dropping in us what we need to do. Amen. Okay, so I'm going to do the waving and holla, and we're going to do the just like we do at Sukkot with the lulav. So waving it north, south, east, and west, above and below. Did not Yahweh say that even I was in Sheol, and what did he say? I was there. So he is all places. Amen.
Bor kud Adonai, humble rock. Baruch Adonai, humble rock, leolam ba'ed. Baruch Adonai, humble rock, leolam ba'ed. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech ha'olam, asher baka b'nimi kol ha'amim, v'natan lanu et torato, baruch atah Adonai, noten ha'torah. Amen. Bless Yahweh the Blessed One. Blessed is Yahweh the Blessed One for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who has chosen us from all peoples and given us his Torah. Blessed are you, O Yah, giver of the Torah. Amen.
Amen. Well, Chag Sameach Shavuot. Woohoo! We made it. Made it through the wilderness. Interesting, I know what Mark was just talking about. The journey, the maturing, the testing brought up the point, and I watched a video some of you guys shared around, and one of the things I took out of that video was another pattern, because we know we can base a lot of the stuff, the things we're going to learn through scriptures in patterns, and the pattern is the pattern of the Jubilee. Jubilee being 50 years. And the big connection for me and all that was the idea, we know 40, right? There were 40 years in the wilderness. There's always, Yeshua was 40 days out in the wilderness. Always 40 was always a time of testing, a time of trial. But if you mix it with the pattern of a Jubilee, you take 40 and you multiply it by a Jubilee of 50, what do you have? 2,000 years. Time of Messiah. So when Israel was at the mountain and they received the Torah, they got everything, the plan, I know the plan, how it worked out is how it was supposed to work out, but the original idea of the plan was they went from the mountain, where were they supposed to go? Right? You get sealed at Shavuot and they go right into the promised land. Well, because of unbelief, what happened? 40 years in the wilderness. When Yeshua showed up to his people in the first century, and as a whole, I know many believe, but as a whole, Israel did not accept, they did not believe Yeshua. What happened? 2,000 years, another pattern of 40. But the good news is, after the 40 years in the wilderness, they did go in. So after this 2,000 years that we've been waiting, We're going in. So, I got to hit you with a dad joke. So you know that we're talking, and this is awesome that we read the book of Ruth during this feast, right? And what a pattern that is. It's like Christians didn't come up with the idea to read the book of Ruth during Shavuot, did they? No. It's our Jewish brothers and sisters. So you picture, you already have the overlay in the Jewish mindset that you're at the mountain, you're receiving the Torah, you're becoming sealed, you're becoming in covenant with the Father, and then they throw the book of Ruth in there. And the book of Ruth is a picture, like Mark, Tammy were talking about, the picture of a Gentile who was righteous being grafted in. Not only just grafted in, but being in the lineage of King David and Yeshua the Messiah. And so they're seeing that picture over and over again each cycle. So don't think the Father's not working and has been working on everybody. Like I say, he's got 40 chests. He's working on all different angles and flavors. So with that, we all familiar with the book of Ruth, right? We got the main characters. Who do we have? Ruth, who does she marry? Boaz. So here's the question. What kind of a man was Boaz before he got married? Ruthless. Wah, wah, wah. If that didn't get you groaning enough, I got one more. Got a quiz. Of all of God's prophets and servants in all of Scripture, who was the most flagrant lawbreaker? Think Samson, think of some characters, can't you? This will surprise you. It was Moses. He broke all 10 commandments at once. Wah, wah. Okay, enough torture. This feast that we're at, Shavuot, and I've ministered to this before, that the idea of, even in land, Shavuot doesn't have all the fanfare, it doesn't have the recognition as the fall, you know, the Pesach time frame and the Sukkot time frame. It's more plain, and probably the of the three pilgrimages, it's probably the one that gets the least amount of attention. But it is the most important. It is the central branch on the menorah. It's this piece here. It's the trunk of the tree. It's what connects all the way down. We enjoy all the fun stuff on the branches, but the tree itself is what's the most important. And this tree, like Holisa has taught before, and if you've never heard this before, picture a rainbow as kind of a first step. This menorah is only half of it. This is the physical half we see on the earth. There's a picture this duplicated and then flipped up. So these actually, instead of being a branch here, it's actually circles. But with that, you actually have that root system, that stem and that root system that actually go the other way up to heaven. And that's actually what's connecting heaven to earth through the center branch. Yeshua is that center. He is in the midst of the candlesticks. That is him. So as you've probably heard that the Father's commandments that he created since the beginning actually make the earth function. And it's actually sin that's caught us into a lot of disruption and even in the natural creation. It's kind of this key here that's tying the two together that's keeping it going. Because the menorah itself was built out of a single piece of hammered work. So that means you actually started with the central axis and then actually beat the rest out of it. So all the other feasts that we enjoy actually come from, and aspects of all those other feasts will actually be within Shavuot. Did you come today expecting? We as a people, as His people, especially today of all days, need to come with an expectation to be changed. Passover is connected to Shavuot, right? And we actually consider it as part of the spring feast, even though it's quite a distance apart. How are they connected? What strings along? The Omer, right? We count the Omer, and we just finished today, the 50. So if we remember back where we started, that was the Passover season. And during the Seder, one of the big commandments we have is to remember and to tell the story. But there's an aspect of telling that story that's unique to just telling a story. Let me know what that is. How do you have to relate to it? Do you relate to it as, oh, back there they delivered Israel from Egypt? No, actually, you're commanded to put yourself in there and explain how Yahweh, the King of the universe, delivered us out of Egypt by the blood of the Lamb. At the same time, as we're, even though we physically weren't there, I'm not that old, spiritually you were. And the same thing with Shavuot. Spiritually, you were at the mountain. So that's why we have to put ourselves on this day at the mountain, awaiting instructions from Him. It is something interesting about trying to picture that, right? So the cool thing about Shavuot and trying to picture yourself there, even the sages actually say that Mount Sinai was nothing special. That the only reason that mountain was special was because the presence of the Almighty was upon it. But after the Sinai experience was over, it was just a mountain. So what does that mean? How does that translate? That means that right outside, this is just plain old Loosedale. But if the presence of the Creator of the universe is here, it can be just like Mount Sinai. Except topographically, we're a little bit flatter. A lot flatter. So, Exodus 19, if you want to follow along. We're going to start in Exodus 19:1. And some of this is going to be a lot of stuff that we've been actually repeating over the past few weeks. So, Exodus 19:1 says, on the third new moon after the people of Israel had gone out of the land of Egypt, on that day, they came into the wilderness of Sinai. They set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain while Moses went up to Elohim. That last line there, the end of verse 2, where it says, there Israel encamped. So here's some commentary from the sages. It says, actually, that verb there, like Mark has actually emphasized before, the verb there for Israel encamped is in the singular. In other words, it's written like Israel's one dude. It's one person, and that person encamped. It's not saying they, the group of Israel, encamped. It's saying a singular person encamped. And the sages say that the people came to Sinai in total unity, like a single person with a single heart. That's where the body needs to be, a single person with a single heart. Now let's jump forward to the time of Yeshua, time of Acts, actually. And we've already read a lot of this, but Acts 2:1 says, when the day of Shavuot had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Now, some of your scriptures might say, instead of one accord, it might say all together. But the same Greek word is all behind it. It's interesting, in Blue Letter Bible, digging into the dictionary there, It says, with that particular word, where it says with one accord, it says with one mind, with one accord, with one passion. It says it's a unique Greek word used 10 of its 12 New Testament occurrences in the book of Acts, and helps us to understand the uniqueness of the Messianic community. Homothumadon, which is the Greek word, is a compound of two words meaning to rush along and in unison. The image is almost musical. A number of notes are sounded which, while different, harmonize in pitch and tone. As the instruments of a great concert under the direction of a concert master, so the Holy Spirit blends together the lives of the members of Messiah's assembly. Does that sound like a single person with a single heart? Absolutely. So that's our challenge today, is within all the dismemberment and all the confusion and chaos that's not only in the world, but a lot of times within the body, right? We need to get ourselves focused on one heart and one person and in one accord, which we know that as echad, the Hebrew word. So we must be an echad, expecting to meet our Creator and to be changed, but not how to be changed. And why I say that is, when Israel came to the mountain, what did they know? They knew they were coming to meet the Creator of the universe, who had delivered them out of the hand of Pharaoh, had destroyed the mightiest army on earth. Did they really have an idea of what that experience was going to be like? No. Like a lot of things in the Father's will, if he would have showed you, you wouldn't have went. You would have seen the movie ahead of time, like, I don't know, is there a plan B? Same time, when Yeshua, and it was read earlier, when Yeshua told them to tarry in Jerusalem until he would give them the helper, did they have any idea of what that was going to be like? Did they have an expectation of how that was supposed to look? No. So, our expectation, likewise, we're in a different time. We're in a different phase of this journey. It will always have earmarks of the original, just like the two events in Acts and back at Mount Sinai both had things that related to each other, like the tongues of fire and things. So we could see that and see those patterns all over the place. As he continues to do the work in you, it will have earmarks, but it may look completely different. So don't expect fire and smoke. Don't expect a giant outpouring of the Holy Spirit, but don't not expect it either. He can do what he wants. What he who do in his people may be very subtle, but it's in here. He's sealing his people to go forward. And I have a feeling it may be a multi-cycle thing of sealing. Just like when the seals in Revelation were opened. Right? They opened the first seal and then this stuff happened. Then the second seal is broken. And then the third seal is broken. How do you picture that in your mind? I know it's heavenly, but you ever think about that? How are they doing that? Are they grabbing a separate scroll every time and breaking a seal? Maybe. Or could it be one continuous and you basically break a seal and the scroll unfolds to a point to where it's ready and then the next seal breaks and it keeps going? So to get that to unfold, there has to be a consecutive cyclical sealing process that goes on. So don't look for a one and done, even though he may do that. It could be a process of continual sealing to get us ready for the walk that's ahead of us. Amen. Continue on back in Exodus 19. We left off in verse 3. And said, Yahweh called out to him out of the mountain, saying, Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, let the people of Israel, tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession, my segulah, among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel. So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set them before all these words that Yahweh commanded him. All the people answered together, once again, like a single person with a single heart. All that Yahweh has spoken, we will do. And Moses reported the words of the people to Yahweh, and Yahweh said to Moses, behold, I am coming to you in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak to you and may also believe you forever. The other thing, they said, we will do and we will hear. Or we will hear and we will do, depending on which part of the story you're reading. But as a people who are following Yeshua, who have the seal, we need to have that same proclamation at least every cycle when we get to this point. We will do and we will hear. But there shouldn't be any reservations or limitations, stipulations that we put on that. We got to a point now in our walk where it's a lot more stable. And it hasn't been too crazy since we've been coming, me and my family, since 07. But I heard the stories of earlier than that when it was crazy, ditch to ditch to ditch, and it was trying to correct course and correct course and correct course, a lot of movement, right? So you had to be very flexible, right? Learning, bending, but always just trying to seek the truth. Well, now it's a lot more stable. Well, here's the thing, though, is as he continues to show us, we still have to be willing to go, well, I like the way we do it. Well, this is the way I want you to do it. We have to be willing to continue to move, to have a pliable, flexible heart. Because at this point, they didn't have every minutia of the commandments. But they could say, we will do and we will hear. Why? They knew the character of the Redeemer. And they fully trusted in him and had full trust that whatever was commanded would be okay. Just like Abraham was commanded to sacrifice Isaac, right? His only son. Abraham had enough faith that sounds crazy, it sounds way out of bounds, but I know even if he dies through this, you will resurrect him because you will not go back on your promise. We have to have that same mindset. So the bride is sealed at Shavuot. We've been talking about this sealing. So this is mentioned in Isaiah 8, verse 16. Isaiah 8, verse 16. It's a very short verse. But it says, to bind up the testimony, seal the Torah among my disciples. Seal up the Torah among my people. So where's the seal going? Among his disciples. What's inside the seal? The Torah. The Torah is placed in us, and then the seal is placed upon us. So what does a seal do? It does a lot of things, right? One of the things it does is it establishes the authenticity of the author. Right? In those days, we've lost all that with the digital age. Things can be corrupted, encrypted, changed, modified. It's a little tougher with things that are handwritten, especially in those days on a scroll or on a tablet. Real tougher to go in there and change that bad grade and kind of make that make that, what was it, make a D into a B, just kind of circle that line around there so your mama don't get mad. But a seal establishes the authenticity of the author and protects it from being corrupted until the time for the seal to be broken and its contents are to be revealed. So he's placing inside of you what is going to be needed at the end of days, and as he goes in, he's going to seal it. That way, it won't get corrupted. And these corrupt days that are coming forth, that's a protection. The Torah he has put in you, as long as you keep your guard up and do our parts, that will not get corrupted inside. That's pure. And disciples, usually we talk about disciples, we think in New Testament, right? That's usually we see that word thrown around, but here we're in Isaiah. So the Father's saying to do this among my disciples. So disciples are ones who have put themselves under the yoke of discipleship. They have learned from the master and have heard his voice. They're an echad with one mind and one accord. But they've taken the time. What did Mark talk about? You have to put this in you. We have to be praying. We have to be studying. We have to be in this. Because if it's not, if we're not doing any of those things, we can't be called disciples. We're called spectators if you're not. So I mentioned before, what was sealed among the disciples? The Torah. And when, where and when did we get the Torah? Shavuot. You see how it's all kind of tying together? And the sealing? 2 Corinthians 1, verse 21. And it says, "And it is Elohim who establishes us with you in Messiah and has appointed us, and who has also put his seal on us and given us his spirit in our hearts as a guarantee." So in a betrothal, which is the picture of Mount Sinai, we've done that many years. This is a wedding canopy over the mountain where he is going into covenant, a betrothal with his bride. But in a betrothal, the covenant is sealed. And it said, "To seal up my testimony," remember Isaiah says, "Bind up the testimony, seal the Torah among my disciples." Well, you can substitute disciples to bride, and you get that wedding motif. It is sealed up, and it is covenant, but it's not fulfilled. That's the difference between a betrothal and the marriage phase. The betrothal is actually more, in the ancient times, more accustomed to the actual wedding because of the seriousness. It was a legal contract. You had to get a divorce. It was basically you just had everything that you had for a marriage. It's just you weren't physically together yet. That was really the big thing that separated the two. And then once the marriage happened, then became the fulfillment. So think of all the stuff that you were getting ready to do. We get sealed on Shavuot, and now we're ready, what, for our bridegroom to come back and to go into the wedding chamber at Sukkot, at the fall feast. Now, with that, we talked about the... I'll get there a second. Let's see, how did we get back here? How did we get to Shavuot? We did it by the counting of the Omer. So it started off, what started the count? What physically, we don't do it here, but if you read the scripture, what started the count? What action? The first fruits of the barley. The first fruits of the barley is done how? They would actually get, right, they would get a sheaf, they would actually out of the field. So you actually had the barley sheaf, an omer, that's another connection. Not only the omer that they collected in the wilderness from the manna, but also the omer of the barley. And they waved that. Now, are you going to grab a stalk of barley and just go start chomping on that dude? That could be yummy. No. You can make barley into food, edible food for us, but my understanding is not too yummy. Anybody do barley cakes and hardtack? Yeah, it's sustaining, but it's not really something some people look forward to as much as other foods. Put it that way. But what is it used for a lot? Animal food, right? Grain feed for your animals. We start off on the sixth day of creation, both man and what else was created? Beast. And we know we have a beast nature and we have a human nature. And we're always trying to battle, right, the two sides. So the idea is we start off this journey showing the beast nature, showing that we're basically just raw. We're immature. That's all it really means. But then through the counting of the Omer, through the maturing process, through the testings, through the trials, through in the wilderness, through discipleship, through maturing, through learning how to trust in His provision, if we could just get that, our fear would go away. If you realize that He's got this, no matter what your eyes see, we could go very, very far. But we can finally get to this point. Now, guess what? We're doing another first fruits. Shavuot is another first fruits festival. And I remember early years ago talking about, well, that's not really first fruits. First fruits is really a Shavuot. No, first fruits is it. Is it this? Is it that? We didn't understand. Yes. Is first fruits at Passover or is it a Shavuot? The answer is yes. But you realize, too, is it's not separated things. They are all connected. The barley is connected to the wheat. It's a maturing process. Because here we are, what did Mark, grab some stalks of wheat and wave that in the air? What did he have in his hands? Bread. He had two loaves of challah. Is that animal food? Well, my animals like it if they get leftovers, the scraps. But no, it's not animal food. That's human food. Human represents someone who's walking in the power of the Spirit. Someone who's walking with the Father, the creator of the universe, controlling our steps with the seal of Messiah on our hearts. So we have man food, people food. So it pictures a mature man. And it pictures the process from going from a beast, immature, all the way up to here. Ideally, this is where we should be. We should be a mature person at this feast, ready to accept the seal of the Torah that's placed in our heart. So the two loaves at Shavuot that were lifted also represent two other things that were very instrumental in this feast back at Sinai. What was that? The two tablets, right? Can you see the two? So how are they connected? The two tablets of the Torah, the Ten Commandments that were given, the Torah is the bread of life. It's our daily bread. So those two tablets are, in fact, in a spiritual sense, bread. That's what we are to ingest. Those Ten Commandments represent all of Scripture. And it even says in Scripture, in a few different locations, they would have a scroll when they were in heavenly realms. What did they have to do? Eat the scroll. Ingest the word. In other words, that word should be inside of us, like Mark has said before. And the Torah has to be in us. We have to eat the scroll, and we have to be sealed if we expect to be at Shavuot, at least as the bride. And that's all we're focused on here. So the tablets also represent the ketubah. So a ketubah is what? It's the written contract. It's the marriage contract between, at this time, Yahweh Elohim and his bridegroom, or his bride, Israel. But here's the thing. But as beautiful as the ketubah is, and as awesome as all the words that were thought out to be placed in there, if you only do what's written physically in that ketubah and don't do anything outside of that, you would be keeping that to the letter of the law. But would you have a happy bride? Any brides out here want to input? They'd be happy if you just, that's all you did. Your wedding vows, that's all you did. Your husband didn't do anything else. Nope, not in the contract. Nobody's going to be happy, right? That is not going to be a happy household. And here's the whole idea. We can't follow just the letter. We have to follow the letter, but it has to go beyond that because it has to be in our heart. There's certain things that we don't have a specific commandment that speaks exactly to there, but we can take the heart and we know the character of our Creator, and we can now apply that to there. We can apply it to our relationships. We can apply it to our work environment. We can apply it anywhere, and it becomes effectual. Even if it's not exactly, thus it is written, you can quote it. We always have to have it in our hearts, but it should spill out into something that's usable to those around us. Another thing we talked about, or part of a betrothal process, is a bride price, typically. Normally, what's a bride price in a Hebrew wedding? 5 silver coins, right? So we know 5 coins symbolize what? The 5 books of the Torah. What does the color or the material of silver represent? Redemption. So here's the idea. The Torah redeems us, and He did redeem us. That bride price, He redeemed us from the slavery of sin in our spiritual Egypt. So the bride price is a down payment, or in other words, could be a guarantee. The Holy Spirit was given at Shavuot as the down payment or the guarantee for the bride. Ephesians 1, verse 13. In Him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in Him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee or down payment of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. Once again, this was given for us to be able to get to the end point. He has not left us empty-handed. He has given us the tools. So if you take the two events, take Mount Sinai, where we had the written Torah given to us. We had a ketubah that was given to us under a canopy. And first century in Acts, it was given, the Holy Spirit was poured out in mass upon His people. Those are all betrothal aspects. And He is getting His bride ready. Yahweh has given us His Son, our bridegroom Yeshua. He's given us His ketubah, the Torah, and He has sealed us with a down payment of the Ruach HaKodesh. We can trust Him. We can trust in Him to give us all that we need for the journey ahead. All we need to do is to say, we will do and we will hear. And we need to be still when He says, receive the Ruach HaKodesh. Receive the Holy Spirit. Amen. Happy Shavuot.
There is a noise There is a sound. There is a cry from the depths of our hearts. Heaven, come down. We'll not be silenced. Can't be contained. The cry of a people, a priesthood, a nation called by your name. Out of the darkness, redeemed from the night, bathed in his glory, reflecting his light. Oh, what a beautiful bride. From every nation, from every tribe, clothed with his righteousness, fully alive. Hear the song of the beautiful bride. What a mystery. How great the love calls to the broken, the orphan, the chosen, making us one. Bearing the goodness, the beautiful mercy of how great I am. Oh, out of the darkness, redeemed from the night, raising this glory, reflecting this light.
all together. Sound the great shofar for our freedom. Raise the banner to gather our exiles and gather us together from the four corners of the earth. Praised are you, O Yahweh, who gathers in the dispersed of your people, Israel. Amen. And prayer for the United States of America all together. Abba, Father, giver of life, we pray for and entrust the United States of America to your loving care. You are the rock on which this nation was founded. You alone are the true source of life, liberty, and blessings. We cry out for this land to be reclaimed for your glory. May it be that you will dwell among your people. Send your spirit to touch and open the hearts of our nation and its leaders to seek your will and your ways. Grant us the ability and courage to stand for the truth, and may we be that righteous nation you have called us to be. We ask this in the name of Yeshua, our Messiah. Amen. Psalm 122, prayer for the peace of Jerusalem all together. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of Yahweh." Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem that is built as a city that is compact together, to which the tribes go up, even the tribes of Yahweh, an ordinance for Israel, to give thanks to the name of Yahweh. For there thrones were set for judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. May peace be within your walls and prosperity within your palaces. For the sake of my brothers and my friends, I will now say, may peace be within you. For the sake of the house of Yahweh our Elohim, I will seek your good.
The Aaronic Benediction. Yivarekach Adonai v'yishmerecha. Yair Adonai p'navalecha v'ikunecha. Yisa Adonai p'navalecha v'yosem lecha shalom. May Yahweh bless you and keep you.
Amen.
May Yahweh cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you.
Amen.
May Yahweh lift his countenance upon you and give you shalom, peace.
Amen.
And it's time for the Kiddush, the blessing over the wine. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Amen. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine, and for giving us Yeshua the Messiah, who said, "I am the vine, you are the branches." And the blessing over the bread. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Amen. Blessed are you, O Yahweh Elohim, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth, and for giving us Yeshua the Messiah, who said, "I am the bread of life."
It is Shabbat, thank the Lord. It is Shabbat, thank the Lord. It is Shabbat, thank the Lord. It is Shabbat, it is Shabbat. Shabbat, thank the Lord. It is Shabbat.